Hello students, in this practical video we are going to learn about the holding torque of epicyclic gear train. So in this practical we are going to calculate the practical holding torque required to hold the assembly of epicyclic gear train. Okay, so this is the instrument to conduct this experiment and to get the practical one. Okay, so theoretically we can easily find out the holding torque because we have the equations, and using those equations consist of holding torque, input torque and output torque, and we have the relation between these three because the addition of these three torques is equal to zero, that we know. So using that equation we can easily find out the holding torque theoretically, but now we have to cross check those findings or those outputs using the practical experiments. Okay, so in this practical experiment we have this particular instrument, okay, in epicyclic gear train. So epicyclic gear train, as we have discussed already, this is that epicyclic gear train of which we are going to find out the holding torque. We can see over here, in this particular epicyclic gear train, this is the central shaft on which the sun gear is there. You can see over here, this is the sun gear which is at the center, and these are the planet gears. These are moving around the gear. And see, this is the annular gear, which is the outermost gear, you can see, which has an internal teeth. Now, as we are giving the input torque, you can see over here, this is the input torque. We are getting output somewhere here, right? And our annular gear is rotating. It means that if you allow this output gear or see this annular gear to rotate, the entire assembly is going to rotate. Okay, so that is not needed. So what we want to do here, we want to hold this particular outer annular gear. Okay, here now it is rotating. Now I have hold this. It means that whatever the torque required to hold this annular gear is nothing but your holding torque, and that we want to find out here. Okay, now what about torque? We are applying the force over here. This force into this radius is nothing but your torque. Now that force you have to find out. Okay, practically that is important here. Now same assembly is connected over here. You can see this part, this blue part is the same assembly. Okay, this is the same assembly, and this assembly is connected to input motor. Okay, and output is over here, right? Output is over here. So as the source is connected to this particular your epicyclic gear train, and which is connected to your output drum, so we can easily find out input torque, we can find out the output torque, and then we have to find out the holding torque. So holding torque is over here. We can see this assembly can rotate. Okay, now we have used this particular strip to find out the holding torque. What we are going to do here, when the gear, this particular motor is started rotating at a certain speed, what happens? If suppose this motor is rotating anti-clockwise direction, then this rotation will tend this entire assembly to rotate in the anti-clockwise direction, right? And then we have to hold it. So what we have to do here then, the moment at which this strip will go from this particular right side to left side this way, it means that this is tending to rotate, and we have to arrest the rotation of this particular assembly. Okay, and the moment at which it is started rotating, that force we have to get from this particular spring balance. Okay, from this particular spring balance we will get this reading, that is called as the holding force from this particular dial. This holding force into the radius of this annular gear is nothing but your holding torque, that we have to find out. Okay, so now in the next section Moreser will give us a demonstration how to get these readings and how to make use of those readings to find out the holding torque in this particular experiment. Okay, so thank you. Now I will
Hello Ben, now we will see the epicyclic gear train.
Okay, so Moreser will give us the aim
and speed and torque analysis of epicyclic gear train to determine the holding torque.
Okay, so you can see, as Moreser said, that now our aim is to find out the holding torque of epicyclic gear train. Okay, so you can see this particular panel which is connected to this particular instrument. So we have seen the three parts: input part, that is motor; middle part is your epicyclic gear train, where we are going to take the reading of holding torque, and here it is your output. Okay, and the RPMs of this input and output will be recorded and noted on this particular panel, right? So you can see this particular first part RPM indicator, okay, which is giving us the input and output RPM. Okay, and there is a knob. Okay, so we can switch over from input to output. If you now this is on the output RPM. Now you suppose this lever is moved to the downward position, okay, and that is your input RPM, right? Okay, in the same way we have voltmeter, we have to nothing to do with that, but we want this ammeter, okay, where we are going to take record of the current, okay, input current. Okay, and there is knob, we can increase or decrease the RPM, okay, so that is in our hand, right? Okay, so now Morrisser will demonstrate us how to take readings and then how to calculate the holding torque on this particular instrument. Okay, so you can see we have three dials. So this first dial, now see that lever, using that lever we can increase and decrease the load on the output. Okay, now how to find out the torque on the output? You can see this first indicator, this dial indicator is giving us a load record, okay, a load record on one side, and this is the load record on the other side. So difference between these two will be the net load on the output drum, okay, the difference between these two. Let us assume that this is your W1, let us assume that this is your W2. So W1 minus W2 is the net load on this output drum, right? So we can increase or decrease the load on the output drum. Okay, so we'll see how to then make changes in that and how to take the readings. And this third dial, you can see this third dial. This third dial will give you the load on the holding annular gear. Okay, so there we are going to get the holding load. Okay, so we are now taking the readings of the loads, but now we have to convert those loads into the torques. How to convert load into the radius? Okay, so this load W1 minus W2 into radius of this drum. So we know this radius, we can easily find out, we can easily measure this. Okay, so this radius into W1 minus W2 is nothing but your output torque. Okay, in the same way input torque can be calculated on the motor, and this is holding torque. So this reading into radius of annular gear is nothing but your holding torque. Okay, so now Morrisser is starting equipment now. So already we have started this particular equipment, and now we are increasing the load. So here this knob, when you rotate the knob clockwise, okay, you can see the current is increasing. You can see the current is increasing, and we are going to see about the RPM. Okay, now first of all we'll see the input RPM. So rotate. Okay, so now you can see the input RPM is 189. You can see over here input RPM, this motor has started rotating at 190 around RPM. Output is also rotating at certain speed. Okay, so we are going to take the readings like that. Okay, so what we'll do now, now we are going to increase the RPM. Increase. Okay. Now, so we can see over here. Now, first the input RPM. So you can see this particular knob is on the input. So input RPM is around 750 or 760. Okay. So input motor is rotating at 750. And this output, so this output is rotating at certain speed, that we are going to see now here. Okay, now what is it? So now this is the output RPM. So we are getting here output as around 140. So input was 760 and output is 140 around. Okay, and in the same way we have to note down the current also. The current is around 2 amperes. Okay, 2 amperes. So now here, therefore, we have to take readings on the loads. Okay, so you can see this first dial, this is called a W1. Okay, this is called a W1. So the reading on the W1 is around 2.5 kg. So that is our W1. So this is 2.5 kg. Now W2 is around 0.7, right? Or 0.5, okay, around 0.5, right, 0.5 kg.
So we have noted down W1, we have noted down W2. Now let us note down the S. Okay, S is, you can see over here, S is around 2.5, right? 2.5. Okay, so this we have to note down. Right, now we are going to increase the speed. So we have noted down till now your input RPM, output RPM, W1, W2 and S. These 5 particular readings we have noted down, right? Now we are going to increase the speed, or we can decrease also. So it is up to us. Now we are going to decrease, okay, input RPM. Now our input RPM is around. So on the first reading we had 760. Now we are now setting the input RPM. You can set to any value. It is up to us. Okay. Now you can see the next input RPM is 704 RPM. Okay. And if you put this output RPM, then you can see. So Morrisor is helping us. Output RPM is around 127. Okay. And current is 1.91. Right. 1.91 ampere. Okay, and now we can see Morrisor is showing us the W1. So what is W1 reading now? 2.7. So W1 is 2.7 kg and W2?
0.4.
Okay, W2 is 0.4 kg. And S, maximum S is
250.
Okay, 2.5 kg. Okay, 2.5 kg. Right. So we have got our input RPM. We have got the output RPM. We have got amperes also. W1, W2, and S. So we have taken two readings. In the same way, we have to take maybe 6 or 7 readings to increase the preciseness. Okay, to increase the preciseness. Right. So in the same way, we are going to take 6 readings.
Hello friend. So we have taken 6 readings.
So you can see these 6 readings we have now taken. So as you know, we have started with say 755 like that, okay? And we had your output RPM. You can see your this input RPM NI, output RPM NO, W1 reading, W2 reading. You know, W1 minus W2 is your net load on the output. S is on the holding torque, and this is RPM. Sorry, this is your amperes. Okay, input current that we had given. Okay, and these are the readings of the input current. Okay, so as we discussed, we can easily find out the holding torque theoretically using a simple equation that is called as this equation: T input plus T output plus T holding torque is equal to 0. Using this equation, we can easily find out the holding torque. But practically, as we have taken these particular readings, so we have again another relation to find out the holding torque. You can see over here. So theoretically, holding torque is equal to, practically we have this particular holding torque is equal to T0 N0 upon N I minus 1. Like, so using this particular formulation, then we can easily find out the output torque. Okay. So actual and theoretical. So here, using this particular experiment, we have calculated the actual, and this is the theoretical holding torques. And now we can observe here, the theoretical torque we have got over here is 0.9, actually is 0.88. Okay, and at that time the ampere was 1.55, like that. So this is not that so much important, but this comes into the picture when we are doing the calculations. Okay, now we are going to focus over here only. We can see these values, theoretical values, are matching the actual values. Okay, so therefore from my side I can conclude here, using this particular instrument practically we can find out the holding torque, right? So when we want to find out the holding torque of any epicyclic gear train, we are going to bring that epicyclic gear train over here, replace that your gear train with this epicyclic gear train, and using this particular setup we can find out the holding torque. Okay, so that's all for this particular experiment. Thank you for watching this video. Thank you so much. Have a nice day. Thank you, Morrisor.